morning on the left, we have Dr. Pines of the University of Maryland, PI of E for USA. Just so you know, gentlemen, we have guests from across the nation, from the 53 schools that make up E for USA, along with All Saints and Give Toe on St. John. We have schools from St. Croix, and we have Scotland, the Glasgow Academy, and their affiliates, I believe, in India, as well as England. Good morning, everyone. Dr. Hall, take it away.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the University of the Virgin Islands, I want to welcome everyone to this global outreach in cultivating STEM. We are very delighted to be working with NASA to put on this event. I want to welcome Dr. Pines and look forward to his remarks and to have him share his vision as well. I am just really excited over this endeavor. I'm convinced that if this nation is to achieve its goals of producing the type of leaders, the type of individuals who can move this country forward and thus help move the world forward, then we need more individuals who are pursuing careers in the STEM fields. These are challenging fields. These are challenging careers, but they are not beyond the reach of students who have a desire to explore them. And so this program, along with other efforts that we are engaged in, are just critical to inspiring young people to start understanding STEM fields, to know that they have the capacity to master them and to pursue careers. Now, the fact that there are students from various institutions in the Virgin Islands who are participating in this event is also inspiring as well. There are times when the Virgin Islands is overlooked, when national events occur, and yet we have such bright, creative, and dedicated students at all levels of the educational system. And I am glad that we will be able to showcase something, have them engaged. I finally want to talk a little bit about our relationship with NASA and how it has really made a difference in transforming the university. It is important to have relationships with federal agencies and other entities that can help us become better. When I arrived, our Edelman Observatory, which we've had for many years, was pretty dormant at the time. We didn't have a director, and I would argue that we really didn't have a substantive program. Through the hiring of Dr. David Morris and his outreach to NASA, we have been able to bring programs to the Edelman Observatory that have now made it a jewel for the Virgin Islands. In addition, through his efforts, NASA has helped fund a program that has allowed us to start a physics degree. We have had a associate's degree in physics, but we never had a full bachelor's degree in physics. And it is because of NASA's support through various grants that we have been able to create that degree, to hire additional faculty members. And we are very proud to be one of the few HBCUs in the nation that can offer a degree in physics. So I want to thank them again and look forward to working closely with them and other institutions so that the Virgin Islands can remain a leader and become an even stronger leader in the field of STEM. We have, as a nation and as a world, a compelling obligation to make sure that STEM fields are not limited to one group of people, one gender. It is something that is going to require us to tap into the resources that is, and talent that lies in so many students and so many people in this nation and around the world. And programs like this will allow us to really open the doors wide so that more individuals will enter and that more individuals are successful. So it is an honor for me to share some remarks. I hope that what has occurred up to now has been rewarding. And I also hope that the rest of the time devoted to this program will continue to be an inspiration. Thank you and welcome to all.
Dr. Pine.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, Dr. Hall. Good morning, other distinguished guests. Good morning to folks from the University of the Virgin Islands, our E4 USA high school partners, and of course, everyone from NASA. Congratulations to the University of the Virgin Islands for hosting this global outreach effort this week in partnership with scientists and engineers from NASA. The world and the US, as Dr. Hall has eloquently stated, needs more K-12 students to consider going into exciting STEM majors. We are delighted to partner with President Dr. Hall of the UVI and high schools in the universe in the U.S. Virgin Islands to administer our Engineering for Us All curriculum. Our goal is to truly democratize engineering for every high school student, not just for students who are interested in STEM, for every high school student. We believe that learning about engineering not only gives you critical problem-solving skills, but opens up a world of possibilities for students to use their imagination to creatively solve some of society's global challenges, such as sustainability, climate change, human health, security, and enhancing the human condition on the planet. My hope is that E4 USA and our various partnerships with high schools and universities will inspire the next NASA scientists or engineers, or even a NASA astronaut or two from the Virgin Islands. Today, E4 USA has reached 3,000 students in approximately 50 high schools in 19 states, the District of Columbia, and of course, the Virgin Islands. We will continue to strive to inspire engineers who create solutions for people and society. I too also want to thank NASA for their strategic partnership with the University of Maryland in many areas, including remote sensing, climate change, and geoscience. We have had longstanding cooperative agreements that have resulted in numerous students, faculty, and staff working with some of the best leading NASA scientists on some of science's biggest challenges. Thus, we are truly excited to continue that relationship through this K-12 partnership with NASA, the University of the Virgin Islands, on partnering with all of us on E4 USA. So I say to Dr. Hall and to everyone who's in partnership with NASA, thank you for the opportunity to share in this global outreach effort to encourage more K-12 students to go into STEM and potentially be engineers in the future. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Christina Chanez, and I'm with Caribbean Green Technology Center, University of the Virgin Islands, College of the Science and Math. And I would like to thank everyone, most specifically Dr. David Morris, Dr. Jan Staff, Dr. Dario Carboni, Dr. Robert Strasbow, and Dr. Michael Henry, all of whom helm the physics program and work with the students as interns at Edelman Observatory. Under Dr. Hall's leadership, we have been successful in having interns at NASA, USDA, EPA, USGS, and across the nation. Our graduates and fellow Virgin Islanders are in key agencies across federal partners and local partners. And what we want to share with you today is Dr. Hall's vision in strategic planning and innovation as it relates to STEM. I hope that you'll all stay on to see what the E4 USA students are doing so you too can celebrate what the HBCUs, minorities, women, and other disadvantaged populations are doing in the field of science, STEM, and research. Zach, take it away.
Hi, I'm Mirza Beg, 18th student, and I love physics.
Hi, I'm Shalani Talama, 8th grade student, and I love biology.
Hi, I'm Sanaya King, I'm an 8th grade student, and I love chemistry.
And we are the UVI Water
Ambassadors and
Future Scientists of
Adelita
Cancrine Junior High School.
Hi, my name is Cecile Penn, and I am a science teacher at the Adelita Cancrine Intermediate and Junior High School. I have been involved with UVI and the Water Ambassadors Program for more than 8 years. On behalf of UVI President Dr. Hall, the College of Science and Math, and UVI Caribbean Green Technology Center, we want to welcome our colleagues at school across the territory, nationally and internationally.
Let me bring you on a short tour at St. Thomas Pineapple Point at St. John Trunk Bay, United States, Virgin Islands.
Notice the clear blue seas and the beautiful beaches that describe Hull, Megan's, and Trunk Bay. Join me as I take you on a virtual tour of the USVI. Megan's Bay. The water is usually very calm with no waves of current, great for floating along and for swimming. The bay deepens gradually from shore, making it perfect for small children. Snorkeling is possible along the rocky coast. However, Megan's Bay is not known for good snorkeling, but for the water sports boat rents, paddle boats, kayaks, and sunfish. Beaches, floats, and snorkel sets are available at the concession. Trunk Bay. Ensconced within U.S. Virgin Islands National Park is Trunk Bay in St. John, USVI. The bay's location within the Virgin Islands National Park ensures that the archipelago reaffirms aggressive, unsympathetic development, making it one of the most pristine of all places in the Caribbean. The area consists of 3/10 of a mile long beach that surrounds a half moon shaped body of water.
But what we want to share with you is what scientists see. The U.S. drought monitors, which are climatologists, meteorologists, and hydrologists, all across the nation who work with researchers at UVI. The scientists from NOAA, National Weather Service, USDA, and many others who use these baseline indicators of droughts. You see, in the USVI, many collect water. To use in their homes from rooftop collection.
Researchers who review this data see is the stress of vegetation, erosion, and compare these images to others taken over longer periods to determine what the impacts of drought are in the USVI and the region. This helps USDA and the Farm Service Agency aid farmers in the territory when severe drought impacts the island. Right now, we are facing drought conditions, and it appears, based on the research here, the territory is headed into an earlier drought season than in years past.
To our fellow future scientists watching today from all across the globe, we hope you enjoyed the presentations presented by students across the USVI and the nation as we learn more from NASA scientists about how we as students can join the ranks of NASA and begin our journey to UVI and other universities and study STEM to make this world a better, safer place for all of us.
And now, on to NASA's presentation.
Thank you.
Dr. Stacy Klein Gardner, and I'm an adjunct professor of biomedical engineering at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. I have the pleasure of serving as the co-principal investigator and co-director of the Engineering for Us All project, or E4USA. The E4USA programs demystify and democratize engineering for us all. The overarching goal is to introduce a broad spectrum of students and their teachers to engineering careers through a high school level introductory engineering course. E4USA is so very proud to be represented so strongly today in this wonderful gathering of scientists and engineers. Many thanks to our colleagues at the University of the Virgin Islands for this opportunity. We hope that more high schools around the U.S. will visit our website, e4usa.org, to learn more and consider joining us. Now, off to a wonderful session.
Hi. Let me extend a warm welcome to my fellow scientists and engineers that are joining us today. Greetings from Brentwood High School at Brentwood, Tennessee. We're just south of Nashville. Good to see you all here. We're a proud member of E4USA for the last 3 years, so from its inception. Some of our projects that we work on deal with problems at the school, such as missing locks from the bathroom stalls and how we could possibly lock them for ourselves. Projects that we work on extend outside of the school through our community partners and partnerships with them, such as with the Nashville Zoo. We're looking forward to spending a little bit of time with you today. Thank you.
Good day, fellow scientists and engineers. Greetings from Brentwood High School, located in Brentwood, Tennessee, just south of Nashville. We are a proud original member of the Engineering for Us All program. Through E4USA, we have learned the importance of the engineering design process, the effectiveness of a strong team dynamic, and the huge impact that creativity has on the entire world.
Right now, we are working on an engineering problem at our own school. Brentwood High School has a separate STEM building from the main high school, so teachers, students, administrators, and SROs have to walk outside on uncovered sidewalks no matter what the weather is. We are interviewing our stakeholders now to make sure we define our problem well. We're planning to address the overall problem using preventative and reactive measures to protect people's belongings.
Before the end of the year, we look forward to solving problems posed by several community partners. We'll create enrichment toys for animals at the Nashville Zoo, design a repair tool for the safety measures around the Nashville Super Speedway track, and solve a problem for the Vanderbilt University Medical Center's Department of Neurosurgery.
Thank you! All Saints Cathedral School in St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands. I'm the head teacher of the E4USA platform at our school. Our students have taken an engineering journey from day one to where they are now. In this video, they're going to show you where we've gone, what we've done, what they experienced. There's many in E4USA, and our students are more than excited to move forward into engineering, even into the college level where they want to go. So thank you for your time. I hope you enjoy our presentation, and for sure, engineering for all.
My name is Ashram Kim. I'm a student at Austin Cathedral School. I am in 12th grade and I really enjoy engineering. Now, let me turn it over to my fellow classmates.
Good morning, my name is Hugh Wing. I'm also a student at All Saints Cathedral School and I'm in the 11th grade. And engineering class is the best thing I ever took.
Hello, my name is Isaiah Francis. I'm also a student at All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade and I'm glad I took the class.
This is a video that we made to reflect on our engineering journey.
Here we are, day number three on our table. Our frame is painted. Good morning, how you doing? All right, you're gonna start by using the drill. Go ahead. Oh my God. Oh my. morning, everybody. We are in engineering. Today, we are starting our robot challenge. Everybody's ears are smoking as they start thinking about how this is going to work. Good morning. Here we are, engineering class, creating a rain shelter. They're brainstorming the process. We will have an update later. Awesome class. Everybody's hard at work. Oh yeah, just engineering at its best.
This is how we do it when the vibes them sweet. We stand up and watch the girl them tweet. Tweet. Them a bubble and a wine for me tonight. Yeah.
And this is how we do it when the music show. They are struggling here. Savannah is struggling. Sophia is struggling how to keep the thing up, but she got hype, but can she do it without holding it? That is the question.
Question. What did you learn from E4USA's robotic arm challenge?
What we learned through the robotic arm challenge is that we needed to complete our objective through set parameters, and through our mistakes and failures, we could better design and make the project more stronger and our prototype stronger.
What are some of the things you learned from your failures throughout the robotic arm
challenge? I learned that there is really nothing called failure. With every fail mistake that you make, it helps you improve and better your design to make the final product, to make it even better, stronger, and more efficient in your project.
How has your initial opinion of engineering changed from?
My first impression of engineering was that I thought that it was just about wires and hammer and all kind of tools. But when I came to the engineering class, I started learning more about the other type of engineering and how it's everywhere in the world.
Good morning, my name is Myrna Hodge-Baines. I attend All Saints Cathedral School. I'm in the 12th grade. And how can you elaborate and describe the five W's?
First, what we want to look at is the five W's. What, who, where, why, and how. What is the problem at hand? Who is the problem affected? Where is the problem at? Why would we create or enhance a design to fix the problem? And how? Through our design process.
Is constructing an underwater turbine ethical?
We have to look through our engineering process to see if it's ethical. And how we're going to do that is by studying the marine life and the people around the Virgin Islands to answer that question.
What can we tell you from what we've learned from the robotic arm challenge into real life scenarios?
What we learned from the robotic arm challenges is there's different types of engineering, such as textile, mechanical, and structural engineering, which ties into our next project, the underwater turbine.
Could you elaborate on why did you choose to do an underwater turbine for your next project?
That's a good question, and that leads into our five W's. For the what, is because we need clean energy in the Virgin Islands. For the who is for St. Thomas and St. John. For the where is underwater between St. Thomas and St. John. For the why is because of the constant flow of directional current between St. Thomas and St. John's. And how? That's the question.
What type of engineering do we have to look at when constructing and designing the prototype for an underwater turbine? Could you elaborate?
The different type of engineering we would use is one, textile. We would test and try different type of sealant to see which one is more effective underwater for the underwater turbine. Another type of engineering we would use is mechanical engineering for the mechanical parts that is in the turbine. Another type of engineering we will also use is electrical engineering for all the wires that's in the turbine, and also the wires that are connected to St. Thomas and St. John, which is feeding the energy. And another type of engineering we would also use is structural engineering for the frame and the stand of the underwater turbine to help it lock underwater. And another type of engineering we would use is cooling engineering, which will help us see from outside and above water what's going on to see if
the underwater turbines need repair or something went wrong in the turbine.
Hello, I'm NASA astronaut Joe Acaba, coming to you from the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. I want to thank Dr. David Hall and the University of the Virgin Islands faculty, staff, and students for inviting me to share a few words and for working with my NASA colleagues to plan and organize this week-long event. All of this in the midst of a global pandemic. These challenging times have been difficult, so it's important for all of us to remain optimistic and resilient. Despite all, here at NASA, we continue to advance the research and technology to return to the moon. We are still pushing forward with plans to send the first woman and first person of color to the moon under NASA's Artemis program. No human has set foot on the moon since Apollo 17 in 1972. So the possibility of landing on the moon is incredible. As a young kid of Puerto Rican descent, I was born and raised in Southern California. I've always enjoyed math and science, but my interest in becoming an astronaut started with my grandfather. He had old films of the Apollo missions, which we enjoyed watching together. I've been fortunate to have so many mentors who supported me and motivated me to be where I am today. Prior to joining NASA, I served as a member of the United States Marine Corps Reserves. I also spent 2 years as a volunteer in the United States Peace Corps. I worked a lot of different jobs until I found the one that I thought and still believe is the most important job on the planet, and that was being a school teacher. For 5 years, I taught math and science to both middle and high school students in Florida. When I became an astronaut, the International Space Station became my classroom. This allowed me to share my love for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics with students around the world. My hope are to inspire the next generation of explorers and leaders and to elevate and highlight the teaching profession and its importance to our society. As you learn more about NASA and all that we do, I want you to remember you are a lot like an astronaut aboard the space station right now. As a result of COVID restrictions, many of you are feeling somewhat isolated and forced to interact virtually with family and friends. But hang in there. Your mission is to remain optimistic and resilient. Before signing off, I want to give a shout out to the USVI teachers, faculty, students, and staff, and all of those nationally and internationally who are joining us from as far away as Hawaii, Tennessee, the Eastern Caribbean, South Africa, India, and Scotland. And finally, to the student presenters from the USVI Cancrine Junior High School, All Saints School, Gift Hill, and Brentwood High School in Tennessee. Thanks for sharing your vision and science with us.
Awesome. Thank you so much, everyone, and thank you to our student presenters at All Saints Cathedral High School and Junior High School. Thank you to Cancrine Intermediate and Junior High School, most especially to our E4USA teachers who are here with us today, and big up to Ms. Cecile Penn, the STEM chairperson at Cancrine, as well as Coach Joe, our beloved engineering teacher at All Saints and coach across the territory. Right now, I'd like to introduce my colleague, Dr. Samuel Garcia, who's going to take us through our journey of NASA careers. Dr. Garcia, take it away.
Awesome. Hi. Good morning. Can
you... You're cutting out a little bit, Dr. Garcia.
Okay, yeah, Zach, if you can go ahead and take over. I'll work on my audio.
Okay, sure. I'll turn on my mic or my camera here and then just introduce myself. Okay. Hi, everybody. My name is Zachary Tursek, and I am a communications specialist at the Kennedy Space Center. I work for a program called Exploration Ground Systems, And we'll get into a little bit more about what that is here in a second. So thanks for joining us.
Dr. Morris, would you like to say a few words while we're getting our technical issues worked out? Okay, he must not be on. No audio. Okay, here we go. All right, Zach's PowerPoint is up, so let us begin.
Okay. Like I said, my name is Zachary Tursek, and I work on one of the three programs that is going to return humans to the moon and eventually to Mars. And that program is called Artemis.
Between 1968 and 1972, America launched 9 human missions to the moon, 6 of which successfully touched down, allowing 12 men to walk on the lunar surface. NASA's next chapter of lunar exploration, called Artemis, has the task of not just going to the moon to create a long-term human presence. On and around it, but also to prepare for ever more complex human missions to Mars. In short, everything we must be able to do here, we must first do here. So, what will an Artemis mission look like? Everything is designed and tested with our most important element in mind, the astronauts. This is their deep space, human-rated spacecraft called Orion, built in 3 parts. The crew module, where up to 4 astronauts will live and work throughout the flight. The service module, with life support systems for the crew and its own engine and fuel reserves. And a launch abort system, with engines capable of pulling the crew module to safety during launch should anything go wrong. To accomplish the task of launching our crew and heavy payloads, NASA is building the Space Launch System, comprising of a cargo hold, an exploration upper stage, a massive core stage, and 2 extended solid rocket boosters. Altogether, this is the world's most powerful rocket, and it exceeds the legendary Saturn V of the Apollo era in numerous ways. Sitting on the launch pad, the entire rocket, fully fueled, weighs just over 6 million pounds, 5.2 million of which is just the fuel. Once ignited, there is no stopping what comes next. All 4 RS-25 engines and the 2 solid rocket boosters come to life, thundering our crew upwards. 2 minutes after ignition, the solid rocket boosters are spent and released. 8 minutes after launch, the core stage is depleted and separated. The upper stage fires briefly, placing Orion into a parking orbit around the Earth. Here, the crew reconfigure the spacecraft and check systems to confirm everything is ready for deep space travel. With a go from mission control, the crew reignite the exploration upper stage engines to leave Earth entirely. The exact timing of this maneuver is critical to reach a speed that can escape Earth's gravitational pull, but also put Orion on a course that will intersect the moon days later. Once the burn is complete, the upper stage of the SLS is jettisoned, and the crew aboard Orion coast for several days toward all that awaits them at the moon. Approaching the moon, we see the fundamental differences between Artemis and Apollo. Instead of requiring Orion to serve as an expendable lunar command module or to carry a constrained lunar lander, the Artemis missions will take advantage of a different approach, pre-staging. Everything needed for lunar missions will be positioned in advance by commercial and international partners. This includes rovers, science experiments, and human-rated systems on the surface. But it also includes a dedicated lunar station in orbit around the moon called Gateway. Here at this station, we can pre-stage a robust lunar lander and establish a strong communications relay. Designed with open standards, the Gateway can be expanded as new missions and partnerships develop, allowing multiple human missions on the moon at the same time and enabling ongoing science to be conducted even between human missions. The Gateway is also capable of adjusting its orbit to allow access to every part of the moon, something the Apollo missions could not do. But the real key in this approach is placing Gateway in a unique halo orbit to perfect the maneuvers needed for Mars missions. And with the growing list of commercial and international opportunities, Gateway is the ideal hub between Earth and all that lies beyond. Returning to our crew as they approach Gateway, the Orion must match the elliptical orbit of the station in order to successfully dock. Once on board, pre-selected crew members transfer to the lunar lander, while those assigned to Gateway remain on station. The lunar lander system itself is built for three unique steps: descending from the halo orbit of Gateway down to a low lunar orbit, descending from low lunar orbit to the surface, and once the lunar mission is complete, launching from the surface of the moon and ascending all the way back to the orbiting Gateway. Once back aboard the Orion spacecraft and undocked from Gateway, the crew fire their engine once to break out of the halo orbit and once again to sling the spacecraft around the moon, placing it on a multi-day trajectory back towards Earth. As they near the end of this journey, the service module is released and the crew module is oriented heat shield first. Entering Earth's atmosphere at 25,000 miles per hour, the friction of air slows Orion considerably, while also subjecting it to temperatures of 5,000 degrees. With the Orion now at just 300 miles per hour, a series of parachutes uniquely tested and produced for this moment deploy, decelerating the craft to just 20 miles per hour for splashdown. With each successful mission, Artemis ushers in the next wave of men and women to explore our moon and prove that together we are ready to go beyond.
Well, that video did a great job kind of explaining the process that we're going to take to get to the moon. And excuse me for 1 second. The video that you watched was an example of a mission that will come after Artemis 1. And Artemis 1 is going to be the mission that, or the launch that we have closest to us. And it will not send humans to the moon on this round. That'll be in a subsequent Artemis mission. But if you're not familiar with NASA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration is a government agency responsible for science and technology related to space. It was founded in 1958, and the agency was created to oversee U.S. space exploration and aeronautics research. And my colleagues work for NASA, and we work on Artemis, which is the mission that was just described. There are three elements to Artemis, three programs that work towards the same mission. They are the exploration ground systems, which involves all of our ground equipment that leads towards launch. And that includes launch pads, places where we assemble the rocket in the VAB, and we'll get into that later, and the equipment that we use to move the rocket to the launch pad. The other program is the Space Launch System, and that's the program responsible for creating the Space Launch System rocket, you can see there. It is the most powerful rocket the government has ever created, and it will take humans back to the moon. And the third program is the Orion program, and that is the crew module, as you saw in the video. That's where the astronauts will sit on top of the rocket, and you can kind of see it in that image in the center there. The Orion is at the very top, right just below that the launch abort system, as you saw again in the video there. And so with those three programs, we will have the capability to send humans back to the moon. I work for Exploration Ground Systems, and as I mentioned, we control all the assets that lead up to launch and eventually launch, and we also recover the crew module that will be splashing down into the ocean when the astronauts come back from the moon. One of the assets that we have is the vehicle assembly building. You can see that there with the American flag and the NASA emblem there. The building is enormous, and you know, we'll kind of get more into the statistics about the vehicle assembly building in a little bit. One of our other elements is the Launch Control Center, and that's kind of the hub of where our where launch will take place. All of our engineers and launch control people will be in the LCC, and they will be running all the numbers and all the programs that they have created to give a go or a no-go on launch day. And our launch director, Charlie Blackwell Thompson, will be a pivot, will play a pivotal role on launch day when she decides. She will be the final decision whether we launch or don't launch. And so that's going to be a really exciting time. One of the other elements we control is the crawler transporters. There are two of them. They're about 6.6 million pounds, and they will move the rocket from the vehicle assembly building where it will be assembled to the launch pad with launch pad 39B, where it will launch from, and that's about a few miles away. Another element that we control is the mobile launcher, and you can see that mobile launcher standing right on top of that crawler there in the bottom right-hand corner. And so the rocket cannot stand on the crawler all by itself, and it needs a little bit of support. And so the mobile launcher does that. And in addition to providing support for the rocket to stand, the mobile launcher also provides umbilicals to support any kind of fluids that that the rocket will need during launch. And it also provides the crew arm, the crew access arm. So the astronauts will be able to walk across the top of that mobile launcher and into the Orion there so they can prepare for launch.
Zach, can you do me a favor and elevate Dr. Morris so that when he's able, they can open the mic?
Yeah, I can't do it right now as I'm sharing the presentation. I'll do it right as soon as I'm done here.
Great, thank you.
So the VAB is extremely important in the Artemis mission because we are assembling the rocket inside the VAB in High Bay 3. The vehicle assembly building has four high bays, and so potentially we could be building four rockets simultaneously, although this High Bay 3 did need to be outfitted specifically for the SLS rocket. As you can see, the platforms there in the center had to be custom built to for the shape of the rocket itself. The tallest portion of the VAB is about 500 feet, and that is about, it can hold 3.5 I'm spacing on my statistics here, but the SLS rocket will be stacked on one of the VABs in the high bay and roll out on pad 39B for launch. The crawler transporter, as I said, it's about 6.6 million pounds, and they were built over 50 years ago. So we've been using the crawler transporters for our missions for a very long time. Through shuttle, we've been using them, and they don't ever go bad. They seem to work forever. And you can see that because they're so heavy, they have their own little road. And if you can see on the bottom there where it's kind of walking or, you know, crawling, it's a gravel road. And because it's so heavy, we have to use a very specific kind of gravel so it doesn't sink into the ground. I'm sure you've heard stories about the crawler being so heavy that gravel is crushed into dust when it passes by, and it'll have to be cleared out and replaced after each roll. So it's a very heavy vehicle, and obviously it's going to be even heavier once that rocket is on top. It's a very slow vehicle. Without the rocket, it tops out around 2.2 miles an hour, and with the rocket, it can go as high as speeds of a 1 mile an hour. So, as you can imagine, it's pretty slow. People, I don't know if you can see it in the picture here, but when it's moving, people walk behind it and just to make sure that everything is okay. And you can pretty safely walk faster than the crawler can move. So as you can imagine, it's an all-day event when the rocket rolls out to the pad for the first time. The mobile launcher, as I said, you can see there in the picture, that's how the mobile launcher and the rocket will stand together on the pad. It consists of two story bases that is the platform for the rocket and the tower equipped with a number of connections and lines called umbilicals and launch accessories that will provide SLS and Orion power, communications, coolant, fuel, and stabilization prior to launch. The tower also contains a walkway for the personnel and equipment entering the crew module during the launch preparations. And you can see the crew access arm there in the picture in the center, all the way at the top there. And I'm a little nervous about heights, so I don't think that I'd be able to make that walk, but I'm not an astronaut. The Launch Control Center, as I said, Charlie Blackwell Thompson is currently the first female launch director, and she is the launch director currently. She will be directing the Artemis launches. This four-story facility was constructed at the southeast corner of the vehicle assembly building, and you could see it in the picture before. The SLS will launch from pad 39B, and today the LCC is going under a metamorphosis of preparations for the next chapter in space exploration. It's being modified in a lot of ways to get ready for the Artemis launches that are going to happen, getting updated in the technology and programs that they will need for the new technologies that we're using to launch this rocket and the subsequent rockets that we build. Launch pad 39B is where we're going to be launching the rocket, and you can see the mobile launcher there. That's from a test that we performed to make sure the mobile launcher was ready for launch day. EGS continues to make significant upgrades and modifications. The new rocket shape and size. Artemis 1 will be the first of many missions SLS and Orion as the agency prepares for its journey to the moon and beyond. In the yellow there, you can see the flame trench, and the flame trench is built specifically to direct the flames from the engines that will take place during launch. And so as you can see in the image, it kind of directs the flames out towards the water here. So just to kind of keep that under control and make sure that those really high temperature flames are not gonna hurt any equipment or any of the buildings around it. In the blue there, you can see we're building a liquid hydrogen storage tank, and that's going to also be for subsequent Artemis missions, because we're going to need more liquid hydrogen to launch that rocket. And we're obviously using new technologies to mitigate boil off of that liquid hydrogen. So it's definitely a cutting edge piece of equipment that we're building there. In red there, you can see the lightning protection towers. Those are towers that are going to be taller than the rocket to sort of mitigate any lightning strikes that happen to keep that equipment safe. It is 600 feet tall. I don't know. You can see a little picture there of somebody painting that tower. So again, I don't think I'd be able to do that, but I'm sure they got a great view from up there. And here you can see a quick breakdown of the Space Launch System rocket. You have your solid rocket boosters, your RS-25 main engines that are part of the core stage right there in the center. The launch vehicle stage adapter makes sure that the interim cryogenic propulsion stage can properly connect to the core stage. And then you have the Orion adapter to connect those pieces together. And then at the very top there, you have the crew vehicle. And then at the very, very top, that little pointy thing is the launch abort system, which is going to make sure that if something happens, the crew there are gonna remain safe. Here are the RS-25 engines, and these are engines that we've used for quite a long time. There are gonna be four RS-25 engines along with the two five-segment solid rocket boosters. It has about 512,000 pounds of thrust, and it weighs about 8,000 pounds. So you can see them testing those engines there. They're very powerful, and maybe after I finish this presentation, I'll throw up some links to some of those engine tests. The solid rocket boosters, the SLS booster is the largest, most powerful solid propellant booster ever built for flight, standing at 17 stories tall and burning approximately 6 tons of propellant every second. Each booster generates more thrust than 14 engine jumbo commercial airliners. As you can see there, there's some early testing of the solid rocket boosters. And you can see that it's quite a powerful machine. It needs to be to get that equipment out into the atmosphere. The core stage, the Space Launch System core stage, is 65 meters long and 8 meters in diameter. This will, obviously you can see the RS-25 engines there, and it is currently in the VAB along with all the subsequent equipment that I mentioned, and it is stacked in the VAB, and we are ready. We're doing our final tests before we launch Artemis 1. So it's going to be very exciting this year. Because it's happening. Oh, you can see the launch abort system there in some better pictures. And here's a launch abort system test that we did a couple of years ago. It's positioned atop the Orion crew module, and it's designed to protect the astronauts if a problem arises during launch by pulling the spacecraft away from the falling rocket. The launch abort system's abort motor generates enough thrust to lift 26 elephants off the ground. That's a strange... a number of the 26 elephants, very specific. And you can see that that this is a test that we had done a couple of years ago of just the launch abort system launching into the sky there. The crew and service module, the Orion will be the most advanced spacecraft ever designed and carry astronauts further into space than ever before. It will sustain astronauts during space travel and provide safe re-entry from deep space and with the emergency abort capabilities. The service module provides primary power and propulsion components until it is discarded at the end of each mission. So you can see there these lab rooms building the Orion and its parts. Very, very cool. And the crew is going to sit in that kind of cone shape there. The interim cryogenic propulsion stage, that is the second stage of NASA's SLS for the initial unmanned flights. The ICPS is planned to boost the Orion capsule into its orbital altitude or pointing direction before manned flights begin. NASA's plans to replace the ICPS with a newly designed second stage booster in the subsequent missions. And so as you saw in the diagram before, this will be the sort of secondary engine for the Orion to propel it further into space. And I think that's it. I am ready for the Artemis 1 launch. I'm so excited, and I hope you will join us on YouTube or when on TV, on the news, when that launch happens later this year. So thank you for your time, and we'll move on to our next speaker, Dr. Samuel Garcia, if we have time. Christina?
Yes.
And here, I'll go ahead and add Dr. Morris.
Thank you.
Hi, good morning. Can you hear me, Zach?
Yes.
Okay, that was a wonderful presentation, Zach. It's amazing to work with individuals that are a part of these different missions and programs. So I'm really fortunate. I too work at Kennedy Space Center. So it is an honor to be joining you today. And today I want to speak to you about careers and different student opportunities for you at NASA. So I'll go ahead and kick off my presentation. But before I do that, I'm going to make sure I click the audio. Okay, perfect. Okay, so let's jump right into it. Zach gave an awesome presentation about Artemis. And so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on Artemis. I will cover it a little bit, but I just really want to tell you a little bit about my story and how I got to where I am today. So this is me. My name is Samuel Garcia. I'm an education specialist at Kennedy Space Center. So throughout my career, I am or was still and still am an educator. I started off as being a high school educator, and you see me there with my group of students. That was one of the last years that I actually taught, which is about more a little over 5 years ago. But I enjoyed what I did. I love students. I love teaching them about, you know, geography and science, and you know, just helping them to cultivate different skill sets and how they view the world. And and so through this journey, I continued my education. I earned several degrees. I did some research when I was at the university, but all focused on teaching and learning, right? And so I applied for this position. I was hired. And so now I'm able to pour everything I know, all my passions, all, you know, everything that I've learned throughout my journey into the work that I do now. And so just like Joe Acaba said, you know, educators, school teachers are so important. And so now I try to best support our educators by providing workshops and trainings and resources. So this was me in action. This was a number of few years. This was, of course, pre-COVID. And so I got to travel. I got to do different things, visit different centers. Actually, before working at Kennedy Space Center, I worked at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California. So I got to see the Mars 2020 rover Perseverance actually while it was being built and constructed in there. So it was a really cool time to be there. And so I never thought I would be in that position, coming from a migrant farm worker family, first generation college student. And so my experiences and my successes have all been linked to the sacrifices and efforts of my family. So I try definitely to keep that in mind and take that wherever I go, because I know that there are many students out there, such as myself, that never really had access to these programs. But, you know, they are tremendous opportunities out there if you just, you know, keep an open mind, work really hard, and take risks. And so now at Kennedy Space Center,
We have a long legacy and history of space exploration, of innovation. This is, of course, the Saturn V rocket, the rockets that took our astronauts to the moon in the 60s and 70s. And so this year we are celebrating 60 years at Kennedy Space Center. This is our 60th anniversary, and it looks very different now at KSC, but this is a legacy. And now we're starting a new chapter with this Artemis mission. I would like to point out that beyond space exploration, beyond, you know, our interest and the desire to learn more about our solar system and universe, we have a huge focus here on Earth. We have different Earth observing satellites and instrumentations. So we need technicians, scientists that help us facilitate this type of research, right? We need people on the ground. We need people to develop these different technologies and help us understand more about our planet. As we saw those young students, they are contributing, you know, science. Their science is contributing to their community, and, you know, they're doing remarkable things there at the in the Virgin Islands. And so we encourage you to participate some way, somehow, in, you know, these opportunities that help you, you know, make a difference scientifically and utilize those skills to, of course, enhance our life here on Earth. Something, of course, just recently, very phenomenal, something that we like to highlight is some of our latest missions, like the James Webb Space Telescope. Just recently, it settled nicely within its L2 destination. So now it's going to begin to collect data, right? So our space telescope now will revolutionize the way we look at our universe, right? And so we had, you know, thousands upon thousands of individuals and over more than 10 years to be able to put this space telescope together, but with the intention of learning more about our universe and provide us deeper insight into how it began and what we can look forward to beyond our imagination, right? And so now Artemis is also a huge opportunity for students. This is a tremendous time to think, to consider careers in STEM. Artemis will, you know, is the next chapter. You saw that first image of where we were back in the 60s, and then this is where we're at now. And no, and this one is even stronger, more powerful than that Saturn V rocket. And so this rocket is designed to take humans not only to the moon, but to Mars as well. And you are a part of this Artemis generation. So opportunities are there. You name it. There are so many ways to get connected and get involved and participate in this space program. And we always like to mention our astronauts. Joe Acaba is a member of the Artemis team. These are 18 astronauts that have been, you know, announced as this Artemis team that are preparing for a journey to the moon. They haven't identified which crew or which members will be crew on that first initial flight to the moon that will be announced after the Artemis 1 mission. So the crew, the Artemis 2 will send astronauts to the moon, but they won't land. And then the third mission, Artemis 3, will land a crew of astronauts on the surface of the moon. But we'd like to highlight and point out that, you know, the first female, the first person of color is in here, right? So it's going to be a truly, truly, truly historic moment. So now you have all these opportunities that, you know, people such as myself wouldn't ever have, you know, back in the 60s and 70s. They are here for you. And we encourage young students to pursue, you know, any and every type of career at NASA. And so I just want to quickly talk about some of the careers, such as astronauts. But beyond astronauts, we have many different types of other careers. Technicians, we know, like a lot of many students, young students like to work with hands. You work with their hands, apply their skill set, so you can work as technicians, work on building the launch pads. Some of you have an affinity for science, plant science is really important. So we had food and plant scientists. We also have opportunities for internships. And so there are many different types of career pathways that can lead you to NASA. If you enjoy social media, we need social media experts as well, communications individuals such as Zach, and many others, geologists, different types of designers, and astronaut trainers as well. And then, of course, we like to always, we can't forget about the arts and their critical connection to space and exploration. So the arts are truly an asset. And so our artists at NASA help develop these wonderful posters that are downloadable, they're printable, and now they're, you know, they're used to decorate walls of at homes of young people or classrooms. And so our artists help us visualize these different places. They help us create the different mission patches as well, and murals that are at our centers. So our artists are busy doing many, many different types of jobs and things and videos. And now we have graphic novels and illustrations. So your skill sets are really important as well, artists. And we encourage you, if you have a deep passion for space, but you really enjoy the arts, don't rule it out as a career. You can also find career opportunities as an artist at NASA. And also our educators, such as myself, we have a great team of educators that help do, you know, professional development workshops for teachers and hands-on sessions with students, either virtually or face-to-face. And then, of course, we have students. Students are critical. We have many student opportunities beginning at the age of 16. You can apply for an internship at NASA. So you can have that, you know, leaving high school, you can have that under your belt and on your resume as you transition to college or post-secondary education. And one more thing, we also have these amazing student challenges. And so there are two specifically. If you're in middle and high school students, it's the first one, Human Exploration Rover Challenge, and then the for student launch. So those two competitions are available. All the other ones are for university students, but these are all things that you can look forward to if you're a young person and participate in and work with your teachers to field the team and put a team together compete in these amazing student challenges. Let's see if this works, Zach. Please let me know if you hear the audio.
Yep, it's all good.
Hi, my name is Claudia Bernier.
My name is Matthew.
Mi nombre es Miguel Marcelino.
My name is Ali Hyder.
Hi, Kos.
Christine.
Bashir Makea.
Kos Catalano.
Tess Von Ruden.
My name is Sarah Adebumi, and I am a NASA intern.
Jesse Moody, and I'm a NASA intern.
Pathways Engineering intern.
I'm a NASA intern.
I'm a NASA intern at NASA Kennedy Space Center.
At Ames Research Center.
NASA Langley in Virginia.
At Goddard Space Flight Center.
OZ Department at Johnson Space Center.
Of the Human Factors Engineering team at the Marshall Space Flight Center.
My name is Tina Schirmer, and I'm a Pathways intern at NASA's Glenn Research Center.
I'm Jamarius Reed, and I'm a NASA intern for the Office of STEM Engagement, working in the Aeronautics Directorate at NASA Ames Research Center.
My name is Courtney Goldman, and I'm a NASA OSIM intern at a Kennedy Space Center.
I'm currently working with the Psychophysiology Research Lab.
I study how nitrogen functions in extreme environments.
In bioinformatics for spacecraft production.
The synthesis analysis of multidimensional ozone measurements.
I supported the X-59 Quest low boom flight demonstrator project.
I decided to apply to a NASA internship because it sounded like the chance of a lifetime to work alongside the innovators and pioneers at NASA.
We get invited to lectures from astronauts, inspiring researchers, and get to hear about smaller missions that I wouldn't have known about.
And being able to work with all of the amazing people here has truly been out of this world.
I like feeling like I'm contributing to something bigger than just me.
All the different projects that they're funding or different projects that they're investing their resources in is really inspiring.
And NASA did an excellent job providing me with meaningful work and making sure that everyone on the team felt included and involved.
From daily or weekly check-ins, my mentors guided and advised me through my projects and any help that I needed.
I feel that NASA is a source of innovation and inspiration for people of all ages and backgrounds.
But you're also around people that are humble, driven, again, passionate, really coming to work, wanting to work, because they care so much about this goal, this mission.
And all NASA wants to see is that you share that passion as well.
Always remain persistent. Everything doesn't happen the moment you want it to happen. Everything happens when it's supposed to happen. So if you apply 2 or 3 times and you don't get accepted, keep trying.
We are the Artemis Generation, and I am proud and so grateful to take part in getting the next man and the first woman to the moon.
NASA welcomes everyone. It welcomes you.
If you're interested in NASA at all, apply online today. I did not think that I could get an internship with NASA, but I applied anyway, and so I think you should too.
All right, there you heard some wonderful advice from our interns, and just want to remind everybody that you don't have to have a STEM or pursue a STEM degree to apply for an internship. You can be in business, you can be in communications and education, just whatever field you're in, you can apply for an internship at NASA. And lastly, I leave you with this challenge to draw Artemis. Visit that link to watch some videos, learn about Artemis, and then share your work with us using this hashtag on social media. So, my friends, are you ready to join our crew? Because we need you. And we hope that you come along on this amazing journey with us. So thank you very much for your time. And hope there's time to answer questions.
Yes, good morning, everyone. We have a few questions. So when is the Artemis 1 going to launch? This is from Bodie Hurst, P7, Glasgow Academy in Scotland. You look like a ghost there, buddy. Can't hear you, Dr. Garcia.
Yeah, I was like, where's Zach? Oh, there he is.
There you are.
So, I don't know why I kind of freaked out there for a second.
Do we know when Artemis 1 is going to launch?
So the plan is to launch it in the next couple months. We have one more important test that we need to perform, and that is called wet dress rehearsal. And that is when we will actually roll the rocket out along with the crawler and the mobile launcher, as I mentioned before, for testing at the pad. And so really our date is going to depend on how that testing goes. And we're planning that testing within the next month or so. So if that testing goes well, launch should take place weeks after that test. So it should be happening soon in the next few months. But again, it really is going to depend on that particular test, because that's kind of when the rubber meets the road, if you will, the final testing to make sure we're ready to go.
Exciting. Okay, Doug Robertson, a teacher at Oxford Prep in North Carolina, would like to know, have they announced the astronauts yet?
No, like I mentioned, they've announced who the Artemis team is. Those are the 18 astronaut candidates that are training for a journey to the moon. But as an official crew of 3 or 4 astronauts, no, they haven't announced those or that team yet.
Great. Okay, so we have questions from Vimsia. That's VI Montessori. An international academy, and they would like to know, this is out of Mr. Houston's class, Eric Houston, how did scientists predict the pathway of the most recent asteroid, and what process did the scientists go through to engineer the invention that predicted it? Wow.
That's an extremely complicated question.
That's a great question. maybe Zach can do some research on that one.
Okay, they have another question.
Okay.
Christine,
go ahead. I'm sorry.
I'll jump in real quick on that one if we want a quick answer on that. So the asteroid pathways are all kind of determined the same way. The invention that allows that to happen is a really old invention. It's called the telescope. And that's really all there is. Well, it's the telescope and then geometry and algebra. So the way that those orbits are all predicted is just astronomers find this faint spot in space that they hadn't seen before. And by finding out that it moves from night to night, you know, with respect to the background stars, we figure out that it's not actually a background star. It's something that's much closer to us and it's moving with respect to us. And as you can imagine, if you can sort of track it from night to night to night, you can predict which direction it's moving in. And it's a really simple thing. When things are out there in deep space, there's not much pushing on them. It's really just gravity pulling on them. So it's old Newton's laws, and it goes all the way back to Kepler and Newton to predict exactly how these things are going to move. And as soon as you've got, the longer an amount of time you can track it, the better and more accurate you know its path. That's why sometimes when you hear about these asteroids, you know, you first hear about them in the news, and they say, oh, you know, there's a potentially hazardous object a bazillion miles away, and it's going to be crossing Earth's path 10 years from now, right? And then a couple of years later, when you check back, you hear, oh, yeah, we figured out that it's going to, you know, pass us 10 times the distance from the moon, so it's not going to be close at all. We just refine and refine those paths as we collect more data on them.
Great question. Thank you for that. That's Dr. David Morris, who is the director of Edelman Observatory at the University of the Virgin Islands. For all those of you in the cold states, I'm talking to you, Wisconsin, Idaho, Ohio, all of those places where it's really, really cold. It is 80 and balmy and sunny and the water is warm. So if you would like to study with Dr. Morris, come and hang out with us at the University of the Virgin Islands. Phoebe Charles Smith, St. Thomas St. John Seventh-day Adventist School, sixth grade class would like to know how many rockets have they made over the years? A lot. Anyone? Okay.
The answer is a lot. so you have the Saturn missions, which I believe were those rockets reused, or I don't know if they were or not. If they weren't, then they had to build a new rocket for every mission. The shuttle obviously was reused to some extent. I don't know if the boosters were reused or not, but there were many, many rockets built. And in a lot of cases, each new mission represents a newly built rocket, save the shuttle program.
Great. Okay, so we have two questions. This is from Glasgow Academy, seventh grade group. When do you think the first person under the age of 18, oh no, somebody, hang on, I gotta go back up. The first person under 18 will be able to land on the moon? Won't Bezos take you now if you have a few million?
The answer is probably not for a long time.
Okay. We have a question from St. Peter St. Paul Catholic School, ninth grade class. How will things look in the future with NASA when Artemis 1 is launched?
Repeat the question. Sorry about that.
How will things look in the future with NASA when Artemis 1 is launched? So I think they're talking about like the next mission.
That's a great question. So right now we are working on each subsequent mission simultaneously in many ways. So we are already building the next Orion space capsule. They are already working on the next SLS rocket. So after Artemis 1, we're gonna go right into Artemis 2. And then right into Artemis 3, because these pieces of equipment that we need for the other missions are happening right now. And so we're hoping to be able to get a cadence going where we can have those missions work more efficiently and sort of build all the necessary equipment and meet those requirements as the previous missions are happening. So that's the plan moving forward.
Awesome. Dr. Gibson of Glasgow Academy has a P7 student that would like to know, will NASA send resources to develop artificial environments to try to grow crops on the moon? Great question.
That is a great question. If anybody wants to jump in, they can. But I don't know the answer to that question. I'm not sure if there's been development of some kind of environment that they would build as they establish a base on the moon. But to be determined is probably the answer.
But we do know at the International Space Station, as in other presentations earlier in the week, that they have successfully grown peppers and other food products in space. So it is happening. So those of you interested in agriculture, biology, environmental sciences, we need you. And obviously, I found this to be interesting, and I'll share this with you. Tortillas happen to be a food item of choice. Dr. Garcia, do you want to explain why? I love this.
Yeah, so, you know, in those early missions to space, they found, you know, it goes back to that time where they, first of all, they wanted to know if humans can consume food, and the answer was yes. And so they found out that, you know, in microgravity, you know, you can't take things that when you, you know, you bite, they'll come out and create crumbs, because that causes potential damage to any spacecraft and hardware. So somebody had the idea of taking of tortillas, right? Because those are easy to roll up and eat. And those are really, really an efficient way to get your carbs or, you know, your vitamins in. And so our astronauts now actually make, they gotten more creative. They actually make pizzas using tortillas. And so they put a little sauce on there, and then, you know, it's a very simple pizza, but they use tortillas now on board there in the International Space Station, because it's just so easy and it doesn't create any mess. So, and that's what they want. They want to keep that place as clean and as safe as possible for our astronauts.
Okay, thank you for that, Dr. Garcia. Students at VI Montessori and International Academy would like to know, do you believe it is possible and continuously affordable to continue Mars research?
I think I'll take that question if that's okay. One of the unique things about NASA is that government agencies are not specifically restrained by profitability. So, for example, a company like SpaceX or Blue Origin, they are privately owned, or rather, I know SpaceX is still privately owned, but Blue Origin might have stockholders. But the point is that government agencies are uniquely positioned so that they can do things that don't necessarily need to make money back to do them. And NASA specifically, the entire space program is meant to explore, to learn, and to educate the world about things that we don't understand, and to understand them better. And so NASA is a unique agency in the sense that we do things to learn more about the world. And the benefits from that come later, as you can see with, the phones that you're using now can be directly connected to the work that NASA has done in the space agency in the past. And so those benefits aren't obvious right away, and there has to be some kind of investment to learn those things. And so that's where government agencies like NASA come into place. Learning things costs money, and if there has to be a bottom line every time, then some of those things might not happen. And so we're definitely grateful for these types of agencies that we're able to do that.
Great. We have two more questions, and then I'll let Dr. Morris close out. So in Ms. Charles' class, St. Thomas, St. John, she would like to know, oh goodness, how many people are allowed in a spaceship? So I guess how much room is there for people in the Lake Artemis? How many people can go?
I was going to certainly let you guys speak to the Artemis, but I was going to kind of jump in with a scientist response to that, if I can, real quick. And I was going to say it depends on what spaceship you're talking about, right? I think most of us, you know, most of this conversation has been revolving around Artemis and the Orion capsule. And I'll let Zach and Dr. Garcia tell me if I'm right. I think I remember it's 4 to 6 astronauts go in there. It's quite a bit bigger than the old Apollo capsule.
Yes.
But keep in mind that there's even, you know, we talk about the International Space Station, which in some respects is a spaceship, right? It's got thrusters. It has to raise itself up when its orbit decays a little bit. So it is a spaceship. It's not going to the moon, but it is a spacecraft that goes around the Earth once every 90 minutes. You guys probably see it when you're outside at night sometimes flying overhead. And that has, oh, I don't even know. They can put a lot of people in there, right? I don't think they carry that many at a time, but it's certainly a big spacecraft. So it really depends on what you're talking about, which spacecraft you're talking about, right? And the Blue Origin guys, they have smaller capsules. So space is becoming a crowded place. Lots of different spacecraft up there these days.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Morris. And we have one more question. Eighth grader from St. Peter, St. Paul. What are the effects of weightlessness on a human being in space?
I can take that one, and you guys can jump in if you have anything else to add. But, you know, based on the research that astronauts have done on the ISS, it's microgravity does have an effect, right? So even if we're just sitting here on Earth, gravity pulls on us, and therefore our bones and our muscles have to work to resist the gravity, right? So they're working right now. In space, they don't have any of that gravity pulling on them. So our astronauts do have to train 2 hours every day. That's part of their regimen. And then during their extended time, which is about 6 months during a mission, they notice bone density loss, and then they lose muscle loss as well. So there are some physical effects, you know, that we can detect, but also some mental and emotional things, psychological effects as well. So our astronauts, we have counselors that work with our astronauts and make sure their mental health is okay. But they're both psychosocial and also physical effects of being an astronaut. And so it's important, just like Dr. Morris mentioned, that, you know, our astronauts there on the ISS, we study, we learn from them, because when we go to the moon, you know, those missions are going to be much longer than they are now, and so will Mars. So before we send our astronauts to Mars, we got to really know pretty much as much as we can. And so we're still learning more, but those are some of the basic things that and basic ways that microgravity affects astronauts in space.
Great, thank you. I just want to remind everybody throughout the day, if you are a national or international guest, you're welcome to have your classes come back. We have a 10:45, which is in a few minutes, and then we have a 1 o'clock. For our teachers who are online tonight at 5 o'clock, you'll be able to ask questions directly of Dr. Morris, of Zach, and Dr. Garcia, along with, I believe, USDA, on resources that you can use in the classroom. Dr. Morris, can you please close out our wonderful event and also thank our amazing students in E4 USA and across the territory, including Kate Grine. You're muted.
Yeah.
There you go.
Oh, now you can hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I hope it stays that way. Okay, great. Well, thank you all so much. This has been a really fantastic presentation this morning. I wanted to thank Dr. Hall and Dr. Pine for their remarks at the opening, presidents of universities that are supporting these wonderful programs, both through NASA's work with us at UVI and the E4USA program, working with our public schools in the territory. This has been really tremendous. I've been saying throughout this week that, you know, I'm just amazed at what this event has grown into. We've been doing this for 7 years now, and it started with a few NASA engineers coming down and presenting at a couple of the schools in the territory, and it's now grown to visits each year to more and more students. We reach all three islands and thousands of students and teachers in the territory each year. And it's really amazing. And not only is it amazing that we reach so many people, but the real impact of what this program does for students in the territory has really become apparent just in the last few years. Again, you know, we've been doing this for 7 years, so that's now long enough that some students that met those NASA engineers that came the very first time have come to the University of the Virgin Islands. We've sent them off to do internships at NASA centers all around the country. We've sent students to Marshall Space Center in Huntsville. We've sent them to Goddard Space Flight Center in DC, Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California. Just this last year, we sent our first students, so excited, to Kennedy Space Center for there in Florida. And many of those students have come back to UVI, carried on their academic training, and some have even gone on to careers now and jobs at NASA centers. So we couldn't be more excited to really see this program coming to fruition. What we always knew it could do, it really, in fact, is doing. So this is absolutely a pathway for all of you students in the territory to research opportunities and a real career if that's what you're seeking at with NASA. And for those of you from outside the territory, absolutely excited to talk to you if you wanted to come down, as Christina said, and work with us at the university for a little while, get involved in some of these projects, and perhaps find your pathway in that direction. So I want to close out by thanking all of our NASA colleagues for presenting today. Zach and Dr. Garcia, thank you both so much for the tremendous presentations this morning. And huge thanks to all of our local schools that provided some of that video content at the beginning. It was really amazing to see what all our great students at Cancrine and All Saints are doing through NASA projects and the E4USA program. Really inspiring. And finally, huge thanks. I hope everyone will join me in thanking Ms. Christina Chanis for putting all of this together. Without her each year, these programs wouldn't be the amazing success that they are, and we wouldn't be able to reach as many people as we do. So thank you, Christina, for putting this all together. We owe all of the success of this program to you. And final thanks. Thanks, everyone, for joining us. I hope to see some of you later today. If you want to get a revisit, maybe ask some more questions. Always love seeing return visits. And I hope to see many of you at the University of the Virgin Islands, and we can carry on some of this engineering and research there together. Thanks so much, everyone. Have a wonderful day.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.